Many years later, people write to me and say, this is probably one of the great classic productions. That's not what I got at the time. I got the time, oh, it's Freudian. You know, again, from ignoramuses, you know nothing about Freud and couldn't see anyway that there was nothing Freudian in it at all. What it was Victorian. I was simply interested in a Victorian childhood, which was what I based it on.
Would you like to talk a bit about Alice in Wonderland?
Yes, I enjoyed doing it. I knew exactly.
Tell me how it came about.
Lillian Hellman had spoken to me when I was in New York at a party in New York, and said, "Why don't you do a film of Alice in Wonderland? No one's ever got it right. It's always been jokey." And I lodged somewhere in my imagination. And several years later, I thought, yes, it would be rather interesting to do it. And then I suddenly realized that it had always been turned into this jokey thing with animal heads, and Disney had vulgarized it with, I'm late for a very important date, no time to say hello, goodbye, I'm late, I'm late, I'm late. And they would always get famous people and then completely disguise them by giving them masks and artificial heads. And in any case, that's not what it's about. It's quite clear to anyone who'd been brought up like I was by a mother who was a great expert on mid-19th century literature and on the importance of childhood to the Victorians, that was what it was about. It was about a Victorian childhood. It's about Oxford. And they're all Oxford dons. And so I got hold of all these artists who all agreed to do it for nothing. I mean, I got John Gielgud, and I got Malcolm Muggeridge, and Michael Redgrave, and Leo McKern, and Alan Bennett, and lots of people, just to do it as if it was a long, hot summer dream in Oxford. It seemed to me to be perfectly obvious, but of course it was always assumed by these idiot invertebrates that of course it had to be Freudian, because I was medical, and that I was modern, and therefore that it would be bound to be Freudian. Most of them were unacquainted with Freud, and it's astounded me that they couldn't see there was nothing Freudian in it at all, unless they thought that the fall down the rabbit hole was, Dr. Miller saw it as a vagina. Dr. Miller saw nothing of the sort. It's just what a child would have dreamt about, getting lost down a rabbit hole. But it was attacked. And now, you see, afterwards, you get this wonderful long years afterwards, you get people talking about it as if it's a great classic. No one thought about it at the time at all. I was just attacked for being a trendy pseud. You see, I've always been a victim of a strange double-sided thing, that on the one hand, I am constantly referred to by cheap journalists as a Renaissance man or as a polymath. And then the other side, which is actually what they're really saying, is that I'm a jack of all trades and master of none. Now, first of all, the people who level this term polymath and Renaissance man are completely unaware of what Renaissance people were like. And certainly, when I consider what my father was like, they would have called him a Renaissance man because he could do sculpture, he painted, he drew, he was acquainted with philosophy, he could write books, and he was a very good doctor. But he would have been appalled to have been called a Renaissance man. It's a vulgar journalistic slogan used by people who just don't know what being a cultivated person was. And that was what my father was, and I was brought up by two parents who were just simply cultivated intellectuals. I mean, I hesitate to use the word intellectual, but that's what they were. They were almost indistinguishable from the people who were part of the Bloomsbury group. But I've been suffering that all my life. You see, I find it almost as offensive to be called a Renaissance man, because it's vulgar and inaccurate and cheap. and also has no either understanding of the Renaissance to which it refers, because they don't know what the Renaissance was like or what the people did or who were examples of it. And on the other hand, it was another way of saying that one's a jack of all trades, called that by people who are scarcely jacks of one. That's why I find it so offensive. But it gets into the media, and it is in the media that most people's opinions are shaped. So that in the end, your image and the way you are represented to the public at large is based on how you're talked about in the papers.